Hey, you guys, this is Dee Edwards, and I am anointed to push, pray, and prophesy leaders into a higher place in God. So listen, you guys, I want to share with you guys really quickly that it is God's desire, it is God's will for you to become a fountain of wealth. That's right. It is God's will for you to become a fountain of wealth. God do not want us to live in poverty. God do not want us to lack. And so I thought it was important that I teach this because sometimes we feel that God is withholding some things from us. But in reality, God wants to release the blessings into our hand, and he do not want us to struggle. You are created for wealth to flow through you. Watch this. You need money for the simple fact that the desire that God placed on your life, it requires money. You need money because there are times where you want to give and you are just so broken to the fact that you cannot give. You need money because there are people that you want to sow life, you want to sow into. There are people that you want to help. There's visions that you want to see come to pass. There are nonprofit organizations that you want to give to, churches and all of these things. So you need wealth and you need money. You are created as a fountain of wealth. So I want to give you guys these three simple tips to help you to tap into your wealth. And I'll be sharing more with you guys about this, because I truly believe, if you guys follow me personally, you guys know that I believe that you can be saved and you can be paid at the same doggone time. You don't have to love the Lord and be broke. It is not God's will for you to love him and then you not prosper. God said that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So whatever it is that is happening in your life that is killing, stealing, or destroying your wealth, that is not from God, okay? God said that he come that we may have an abundant life. And so for me, I don't know what your confession is, Sierra. I don't know what yours is, Kay, Rikita, or Brenda, but my confession is that I live an abundant life. And that means that I have more than enough of moolah, money, okay? So let me eradicate the lie of the devil real fast, right? The love of money is the root to all evil. But having money, wanting money, and loving what money can do is not the root to all evil. As a matter of fact, Ecclesiastics says that money, it answers all things, okay? So let me just free you from that. Let me tell you that it's in the Bible that money answers all things. Think about the situation that you're in right now, Nikki. Teresa, y'all think about the situation that you're in right now. Can money take a weight off your life? Absolutely it can. Can money relieve you? Absolutely it can. Okay. So when you begin to think about wealth and becoming a fountain of wealth, it's not just regarding money, but money is a portion of it. Okay. So free your mentality. You're going to have to shake that off. And the reason why I need to teach this is because I grew up in a poverty stricken mentality, environment, community. And so to desire to want more, it was almost like it was a sin. To live an abundant life, it was a sin. People will make you feel, Benita, like you greedy when you want more to life, when you're not satisfied with what you have. You know, Paul said that he learned to be content with whatever situation that he's in. I learned how to be content, but I won't be satisfied being poor. I won't be satisfied being broke. I will not be satisfied living from paycheck to paycheck. I won't be satisfied that I can't put my children in certain camps and buy things that are necessity. Watch this. The things that are necessity, I won't be satisfied with that. So you got to remove the mentality that's been in your way to tell you that being wealthy, it is a sin. Absolutely not. It is the will of the Father for you to have wealth. And so I want to teach these three pointers. There are many pointers to getting wealth, but I want to teach these three main foundational teachings that will help you to become the wealth foundation. Okay. A fountain. And let me say hey to you guys right now, because I know some of you guys will not share this broadcast out. Some of you guys are going to jump off because some of the things that I'm teaching you guys is important. And so you guys know that, for those of you all who don't know that I am a pastor's wife, but the reason why God has given me this ministry is because I have to teach his people outside of the church. Because sometimes when pastors start teaching about money, you think that they're going to ask you for something, right? And so God told me to teach his people so that his people can experience an abundance of life. Okay. All right. So first of all, I'm not going to ask you for no money. I'm not going to ask you to sow a seed. Okay. I'm not going to ask you to do any of that. You do that, whatever, however God leads you. But what I am going to do is to ask that you open up your heart. I'm going to ask that you open up your mentality and fully hear what is being deposited. Don't just hear what I have to say. Hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying through my teaching. Because the Bible said that those who have an ear need to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And so today I pray that you will hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. I normally don't get on live and teach back to back. So I know that this is the Lord. And so I want God to do something in your life when it comes to your financial situation and to you obtaining wealth. So first, I'm going to say thank you for sharing this broadcast out. So if you guys have not shared it out, I'm definitely going to ask that you share it out. Okay. All right. So the first thing, y'all, Lord have mercy. I'm like, God, I don't know where to start, from the top or the bottom, because I already know that y'all going to come at me, you know. But the first thing that I have to tell you guys is that, let me say this to you. Let me give this disclaimer to you all. The tips that I'm giving to you all, I know that they work because I have followed them and I am following them. And these are the tips that have broken poverty off of my life. Yeah, I wasn't just born into a poverty family. Poverty was in my bloodline. It was a generational curse. Poverty had hindered my family from moving forward. And I told God, I don't want to be like that. Okay. Like if I've seen it my entire life, Lord knows I did not want to be like that. And I didn't want to raise my children like that. So I knew that there had to be something different that I do in order to establish a new bloodline, in order to be a part of this inheritance that the Lord have for us. So thanks so much for sharing, you guys. Okay. Sierra said, I want to sow more, but I need to be taught more concerning money. Absolutely. Thank you. Shake you so much for being open-minded concerning this topic, because it's a very difficult topic for to hear, and because I'm going to challenge what you already know. I'm going to challenge what you've already been doing, and I'm going to challenge you to step into the spirit of truth, because some of you all have been believing the lies of the devil when it comes to your finances. So I want to teach you to step into the spirit of truth. Okay, so the first thing I want to share with you guys is that you have to become a tither. Ugh. You got to get to a point where giving your tithe, that it is non-negotiable, right? So if you were to read in Malachi said, how can a man rob God? And God said that you are robbing me because you are not paying, you're not giving your tithe and your offering. So watch this. God don't need money, but he needs the relationship that he have with you. And so being able to trust God with 10% means that, God, I value the relationship that you and I have. Y'all need to hear this. I'm not just because God don't care about the amount of your 10%. He cares more about the relationship. And so when you really truly trust God, you understand that the relationship that you all have is bigger than the money. And so God uses the tithe principle to discipline us to build the relationship. Y'all need to hear this. Oh my God. Oh my God. This is discipline you to building the relationship. So it's not about just money, y'all. Okay. So it's not about money. It's about building a relationship with God. Okay. And so when you give of your tithe, you realize that God has given you 100% of your income. He's given you 100% of your income. And so God has said, give me 10%. 10% is a way that you honor him. So you're saying, God, in spite of the bills that I have coming up, in spite of what I have to do outside of this, I'm trusting you enough to give back to you 10%. And God loves us so much. Nikki, watch this, that he loves us so much that within the time period that you're expecting money to come, God will give you that 10% back in good measures. He'll give it back to you in good measures. Somebody will sow into your life. Somebody will buy a meal for you. You know, your debt may be decreased. You may find some money like that. 10%, it comes back to you in good measures. So here's the challenge that a lot of people have, is that when you're looking at the amount of bills that you owe and you're looking at this 10%, content, you're saying, God, it's hard for me to release it because I know what I have. And God is saying, I know what you have to pay, but will you trust me enough to give it in spite of? Lord have mercy. It's a trust factor. So I want you guys to get your eyes off of the money perspective and look at the relationship and the trust factor. Okay. And so God said that when you trust me enough, he said that I will open up the windows of heaven that you would not have enough room to receive. And so, Joan, that means that when the windows are open, it's more than what you have given in tithe. It's more than what you have given in tithe. And so for tithing for me had to become non-negotiable. I had to learn not to compromise in tithe. As a matter of fact, I had to learn how to trust God. I had to trust God. Hey, coach. I honor my coach. Hey, coach. Hi. I had to learn how to trust God enough to give him the tithe, to give him what he was due. And so a lot of times we're asking God to increase our wealth and to give us more. But in reality, we have not learned to make tithing non-negotiable and uncompromising in our life. Okay. And so when you don't tithe, the Bible said that you're living under a curse. So you're living under the curse of debt. You're living under the curse of lack. You're living under the curse of poverty. And so tithing have to become non-negotiable for you so that you can tap into the fountain of wealth. And so I started tithing. I started understanding the principle of tithing when I was about 21 years old, and I'm 39, and I've never missed a tithe since then because I understand the concept. I understand what God is doing. I understand my relationship with him. Lord have mercy. Thank you so much for sharing this out. So I know this is hard for some of you all to receive, but it is the truth. Okay. And so I got into a place where I said, God, I'm going to give you my 10%. And so I need God to do something else in my life, and I needed God to know that I trust him more. So I'm just going to tell you guys what I did. What I did was I increased the percentage of my tithe. So now I give 30% of my income in tithe. You know why? Because every time I'm saying, God, I trust you even the more so. I trust you more. My relationship with you is growing even the more so. So whatever that I have, I want God to know that I trust him with it. So now my tithe is 30% of my income. 30%. Because what I realize is that whatever I do unto God is not a loss for me. And somebody needs to really catch this, that whatever you do out of obedience is not a loss for you. It's not a loss for you. And the devil will make you feel that when you're giving to God out of obedience, that you're losing something. You're not losing. As a matter of fact, you're breaking some things off of your generation, y'all. This thing is bigger than you. You're breaking some things off of your generation. You're breaking the spirit of poverty and lack. Okay. So that's tip number one. Tip number two is I had to learn to be a giver. I had to learn to be a giver. So where I come from, because I grew up in poverty mentality, my hands stayed like this. So whatever came in my hand, coach, I will always just keep it. I will hold on to it. As a matter of fact, I will lord over it. I will watch it. And as long as I watched it, I was like the guy with the talents who hid what the master had given him. I was hiding what God gave me. I was not releasing it because I felt like if I gave it, if I sold it, then I was going to lose out. And God began to teach me through a teaching with Mike Murdoch. And it said that whatever leaves your hand never leaves your life. And that's something that I had to learn to really grasp onto. Because if the devil is trying to make you hold on to it, then that means that he's trying to make you abort what you would have gotten when you would have given it. Okay. And so I had to break the poverty back in my life by learning to give. I had to learn how to release what was in my hand and to realize that I was not losing out when I gave. So watch this, because some of you guys saying that, oh, you know, I don't know if the ground is good. So the other day, as my daughter and I, we were going to get ice cream, and there was a lady who walked up to us, and she had this bogus excuse as to why she needed some money. I gave the money to her, and then my daughter said, said, look, mommy, she lied. And I said, okay, yes, baby, I lied. And so some of you guys would have said that that was bad ground that I sold into. But in reality, it was good ground because I'm the good ground. Watch this. I am the ground in which I give my seed. So it's not about what the person do with the seed that I give them. I had to realize that I am the good ground, not the person, not the building, not the ministry. I am the good ground. And because I gave and my motives was right when I gave, God can bless it. Y'all, listen, thank you for sharing this out. You guys need to hear this. This is how you get the foundation of wealth. It's learning to release. You got to release. You got to learn how to put your seed somewhere so that it can grow. And as long as you're holding on to it, there is no growth. As long as you're holding on to it, you will not see the power in what that seed can really do in your life. And so, like, for instance, I'm in real estate investment. If I would have never purchased, my husband and I, when I say I'm talking about the both of us, because when you see me, you see him. And so what I realized is that if I would have never sold or never bought property, then I would never see the return from my giving to purchase that property. And so giving, it creates a residual income. See, some of you guys are trying to produce residual income in the natural, but actually your giving creates a residual income. Y'all need to hear this. Listen. Your giving creates residual for you. And it may not come necessarily in the form of money, but it may come in the form of favor. It may come in the form of an opportunity. It may come in a form of something just supernatural because you trusted God with your giving. You're trusting God. So anytime that you're holding on to something like this, like for instance, let me tell you how you know that you're still wrestling with the spirit of poverty. You can be sitting in church and the pastor gonna ask for some money, and you'll say in your mind, oh, they better not ask me for nothing. Some of you guys are saying right now, she better not ask me to sow. You know what I'm saying? That's how you know that you're struggling with poverty, because the devil will try to talk you out of giving. He will make you look at giving from a negative perspective. He really will. And so you have to change the way that you see giving. And the way that I broke it off of my life is that I intentionally became a giver. I intentionally became a giver. So some of you guys may be saying, well, D, how can I give when I really don't have anything to give? You have it to give because God gives seed to the sower. So you have to understand that God will give you seed. And so this is how you break it. All right. So what I did was I started giving what I had. So there were times that I would give in church, but then there would be times I would take the earrings out of my ear, y'all, and I would give it to somebody. There were times where I would go in the store and I knew that my coworker liked a drink, and I would go in, I would buy their drink, or I would buy somebody lunch. I would do like the little things that I could within my own measures. And then before I knew it, this thing began to grow. But before I knew it, I saw that my financial situation was changing because I intentionally became a giver. And anytime that I feel that, you know, my finances may be like this, I put seed in the ground. I sow. I look for an opportunity to sow. I give. Now, I'm a responsible giver. Watch this. I'm a responsible giver, but at the same time, I understand that I am a fountain of wealth. And so because I'm a fountain of wealth, I start thinking about a continuous stream. I start thinking about a river that continuously to flow. And so I'm asking God, how can this wealth continue to flow in my life into the generations to come behind me? God said, continue to give your tithe and to be continue to be a giver. Okay. All right. Those are the two things. The last thing that I want to tell you guys on how you can create this foundation of wealth is to ask God to help you to become a good steward over what you have. So y'all, I was, listen, the money and what God wanted to do in my life, it was coming in, but I was not a good steward over what God was giving me. So for instance, I was an emotional spender. So I would stay up at night and I would buy all of this QVC stuff. I would stay up at night and buy all of the workout tape, the Runco knives, the Body by Jakes, all of these DVDs and all of these things. And so God was telling me, D, you're not being a good steward. So it looked like the money have holes in your, it looked like you have holes in your pocket. It looked like I have not kept my word concerning you, but in reality, I'm giving it to you, but you're not storing it. You're not storing it. I felt like I had to have, at that time, like the latest Air Max. I had to have the latest whatsoever. And God said that you, he said, D, you're taking your money that I've given you and you're putting it into a ground that cannot reproduce. Watch this. When you learn to store it, you understand that what you do with your money, you have to deposit it and put it into a place where it can reproduce for you. That's what good steward does. When you begin to think about multimillionaires and billionaires, what do they have? They have real estate property. Why? Because they're taking the money that they have, they're taking the wealth that they have, and they're putting it into a place where it can reproduce for them. That's why entrepreneurship is good. That's why real estate is good. You got to learn to put your funds in a place where it can reproduce instead of saying that I need the latest purse. I need the latest shoes. Now, y'all know I like to stay fly, but keep in mind that I'm not staying fly to the point that I'm not stewarding over what God has given me. You have to learn to steward well what God has given you. Some of you all are driving the most expensive cars, and I ain't judging y'all because I did that. Y'all, I was driving a vehicle. The car payment was $600 and some. That was just for the car payment. That was not the insurance. That was just the car payment, okay? Some of you all are living in bigger houses than what you're supposed to be right now. If you were only downsized and then downsized the rest of your debt at the right time, God will lift you up to the point where you can get the house. You can get what you desire because you steward well. You have to learn to steward well. Some of you all need to be cooking instead of eating out. Okay? You got to steward well until you get to a place where God truly desired you to. These are the three principles that I had to learn to apply in my life when I was over $100,000+ in debt and had nothing to show for it. Over $100,000+ in debt. Do y'all understand what it feels like to have over $100,000+ in debt? Okay? In debt? Yeah, that's a burden within itself. So I had to learn. I said, God, okay, this is where I am right now. You know what our financial situation is. How can this change for us? And these are the first three principles that God gave me. Okay. And so I don't know where you are in your financial circumstance. I don't know where you are in your situation, but out of the three, you need to pick one that you're going to master. And after you master the one, then add another one, then add another one. You should always be growing when it comes to your giving and your financial situation. You should always be growing more and more. Master a principle, stick to that until it become unwavering for you, and then grow in other areas. Thank you so much for sharing this out. Because if you try to do, some of you all can do all three of them right now, but some of you all will become overwhelmed because this generational poverty curse have been upon you and your family and in your bloodline for many years. And some of you all need to read Deuteronomy and look at what happens when you're under a curse, like a financial curse. Read Malachi. And build a relationship with God. Because as your relationship with God matures, you want to do what's pleasing to the Father. There's no way that you want to really please the Lord and you have not adopted the first principle when it comes to your finances is paying your tithe. You should desire more of God to the point that, God, I don't want to do anything that will cause me to grieve the Holy Spirit. I don't want to do anything. And so, God, if that means that I got to release 10% of my income of what you have given me, then God, let me release that. We got to get to a place where it's uncompromising. Watch this. If non-believers can follow the system, this system here, and they can reap because of a system that God has implemented and created on the earth, it works for anybody. Watch this. It works for anybody. So whether people are a believer or not, it works for them when you follow the principle. So if it works for an unbeliever, then what more? What more does God want to do with you who pray and seek his face, that go to church and you know, disciple? What more does God want to do for you? It's more that God wants to do for you. Okay. And so you have to look at the three principles that I gave you guys today. And you have to say, God, where have I been failing? Where have I been lacking? And if some of you all are looking at this list and saying, oh, I do this, and I do that, that's the spirit of pride. And I break it today, because the Bible said that pride comes before a haughty fall. That's the spirit of pride. You should look at these three and say, God, okay, even if I'm doing these things, how can I increase it more? How can I give more? How can I steward better, even the more? Because the Bible said that you should go from glory to glory. There should be a new glory realm in your finances that you hit. Okay? All right, so God wants to release it. So thank you guys so much for sharing this out. There's so much that God wants to give to his people. He wants to give it to you. It's not his desire for you to be broke. It's not for his. You think God wants to hear when you go to prayer all the time about your financial situation? Absolutely not. So that means there's a principle that is lacking. Yes, God. Woo! That's a principle that's lacking. If you have to constantly go to God regarding your finances and then nothing is changing, that means that you have not implemented a principle. You're missing the principle. Woo, that was good for me. That was good. Because some of you all are praying. You're praying, but you're not seeing nothing change. That's because you have to learn to implement the principle. Just like some of you all were here, what I'm saying today, and nothing changed. You won't do nothing. But some of you all who have an ear to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying, then you're going to figure out a way that you can do better, or you're going to figure out a way to do one of these principles. I'm here because the Lord is trying to give his people more. I'm here because there's more that God wants to do in your life concerning your finances. Okay. Oh, hey, Shonda. I remember. There's more that God wants to do. And I'm just here as a teacher of the Lord to show you one of the three areas that you can improve, so that the fountain, the rivers, thank you, Father, the river of wealth can continue to flow, so that God can give you more creative ideas, so that the screens of income that you've been praying for, so that it can come into your life. The rivers, it's time for the rivers to flow. It's time for the rivers to flow. Yep. Sharon said, I got it. Sharon said, I got it. Yes. Thank you, Sharon. Joan said, God is speaking through you, and all who have an ear, they need to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Yes. Rakita said, implementation in his principle would change your circumstances. It would absolutely change your life. It would change your life. Okay. Benita said, I hear you, Lord. That's right. Don't just hear me. Hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying regarding your financial situation, so that this burden that the Lord did not give you can lift. You think God would give you this burden? This burden is not from God. This is a burden that's from the devil. He come to rob you. He come to steal. He come to kill. He come to destroy. That's what the devil do. Sarah said, I received this much needed. I knew something I'm missing. I have integrity, but it wasn't adding up. Come on now. Yep. It's just a principle. And don't feel bad, because this is not to bring condemnation, but this is to bring you out of the dark into God's light. Yes, to bring you in the light. Some of us are in the dark regarding certain things, and then God will bring the light to expose so that you can go higher. So if you don't do anything after listening to this live, it's not God. It's not God. It's you. It's in your hands now. What are you going to do about it? Thank you guys so much for sharing this broadcast out. Thank you guys so much for sharing this out. Thank you. Chastity said that I received this message. Thank you, Father. Yes. Thank you, Father. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Remember that you can push, pray, and prophesy. This is D. Edwards, and I will see you guys at the top. Toodles for now.